So let's head over to my computer. So we're on the Mac version. Sorry, I'm not booting into Windows just to show you the differences, but I do want to talk about that. So the first and most obvious one is the keyboard shortcuts are going to be different. Presented by Church Tech U, it's the ProPresenter Show. On today's show, the differences between the Mac and the Windows versions of ProPresenter. Hi, and welcome again to the ProPresenter Show. This is the show where I teach all about ProPresenter. My name's Paul Allen Clifford. And before we get started, if you're curious the differences between the Windows and the Mac version of ProPresenter, go ahead and like, subscribe, etc. One thing that Renewed Vision has done a fabulous job of with the advent of ProPresenter 7 back in 2020 and subsequent versions is the Windows version and the Mac version, they're on parity with one another. They're very similar. In my classes, I tell people they're 99.9% the same. For the vast majority of things, people that aren't as heavy into ProPresenter as I am won't notice the difference. But I thought that I would mention some of the differences in case there's something that you find that would persuade you to go with one over the other than personal preference, which in general is probably the biggest reason to choose one over the other. So let's head over to my computer. So we're on the Mac version. Sorry, I'm not booting into Windows just to show you the differences, but I do want to talk about that. So the first and most obvious one is the keyboard shortcuts are going to be different. In general, on Mac OS, if it's Command, it's Control on Windows. That gets you most of the way through. There are a few other differences. Speaking of keyboard shortcuts, on the Mac version, if you go to ProPresenter and then down to Key Mappings, you can change the keyboard shortcuts there. And so I've shown you this before. If not, go look for the tutorial on that. But it's not located there in the Windows version. It's actually located under Edit. I don't know why. It just is. So that's something else for you to know about, that it's under Edit in the Windows version. Another thing is, speaking of Edit, let's choose a song here, and I'm going to right-click and select Edit. I could have also just selected it and gone to Edit up here. Either way, Edit Slide. And when I do that, when I click on this and go over here to Text, you'll notice that I have a place right here where I can change the color of the text. I also have this right here, which showed up on a different screen, so I will drag it over. I can get my mouse to act right. Okay, there we go. So this is one of the color pickers here. This color picker is going to look different on Mac OS than Windows. So the reason behind that is this is the system color picker in Mac OS. But there is no system color picker in Windows, so Renewed Vision wrote their own. So if you're in Windows, you will see a color picker that is somewhat different. While we picker, I have another important thing for you. This opacity slider, in this case, it affects the opacity of the text color. But where I use it most is if I go and I fill the background here and I were to change the opacity of it, I would change it here. Now, you might say, but there's an opacity slider here. The reason that I'm saying to change it here is this changes the opacity of the color that I have added. This changes the opacity of the entire shape, the entire text box, including the text itself. So it matters there. It's a little different in the Windows version, though, because the color picker is different. So what I can do, here, let me uncheck this, is if you go into the color picker, there is an A button. You click on the A button, and you can slide the slider there. So that's another one of those little differences between the two. Another difference is if we go to screens and configure screens, when I add a screen here, if you are on Windows, you don't have siphon as an option. Not all that big of a deal, because you can use NDI, which you do have as an option, to do exactly what siphon does in macOS. Siphon is an older technology that only sends the video portion of the signal out via a siphon screen. So that's a downside, because it doesn't send audio. It's also a downside because it doesn't send it over the network. It only sends it to other software on the same computer. So if you're on Windows, just use NDI and you can send it to other software on the same computer with audio. Or you can also, just like on the Mac version, send audio and video over the network to some other device, either another computer, or they do make NDI decoders that can see NDI. So that is another thing that you can do with it. And so that's a difference without necessarily a downside. The last one that I'm going to go through, unless another one pops into my head, is if we go to, do you like these videos, but you'd really like to learn from me in person? Well, I've got some great news for you. I am traveling around the country and maybe even around the world training churches on how to use ProPresenter. So I've got either a 1 or 1.5 day class that you can attend. For more details, head on over to tdm.fyi/events24, the top one right here, and register for the event nearest you. If there is no event that's near you, no problem. You can request one. So head on over to tdm.fyi/class request. That's this one down here. And you can say, hey, I'm interested in attending a class, or even I'm interested in hosting a class. Up to you which you prefer. In the last one, that is just information. It's not obligation, so don't hesitate to put your information in there, and I'll let you know when there's a class in your area, or we'll talk about what it takes to host a class. It's probably a lot less than you imagine that it is. So head over there, and I look forward to meeting you in person. Let's see here. First off, let me go back into show mode. The other thing is, if I'm going to import PowerPoint, which I strongly, strongly encourage pastors that are using ProPresenter in their church not to use PowerPoint. Strongly recommend you don't do this. PowerPoint is really, they haven't added anything all that useful in years. There are, oh, look, we've got this thing, and you're like, and I'm never going to use that. So I think that it's just not as good as it could be. But with that said, if you're going to import PowerPoint into ProPresenter, go File, Import, and then go to PowerPoint right here. You can import it in both macOS and Windows, but you might think that the Windows version is going to be better, and you'd be wrong, because in the Windows version, it will only import still images of slides. But in the macOS version, if you click on Show Options, we've got three options. The first one is just still images of the slides. That's the same. The second one only imports text objects from PowerPoint, but it brings those in as slides. So that's pretty cool. You can edit the text, you can fix typos, other fun stuff like that. The last one imports both text objects and graphic objects. Does not bring in videos, so you will still need to go into PowerPoint to import the to grab any videos that have been embedded in there. But you export that video, bring it into ProPresenter, and otherwise this will import text as a text box inside of ProPresenter, and then graphic objects like images as images on the text layer or on the slides layer in ProPresenter. So normally this is the one that I choose. One thing for you to know is if you're in a situation where your presentation computer is a Windows machine, if you have anyone on your team that has a Mac, a fairly recent Mac, they could download the free version of ProPresenter that has the watermark on it. And as long as they've got PowerPoint on their Mac, they could import the PowerPoint for you and then export it and send it to you. Just the same way you could get a file to your computer any other way, you know. Probably email isn't going to work because it's going to be a larger file size. But other than that, you could do Dropbox, Google Drive, a thumb drive, an external hard drive, etc. So there's several ways of getting that file. And once it's imported on a Mac and then exported and sent to the Windows version of ProPresenter, then it'll work perfectly fine. So you're not necessarily out anything. One final thing just popped into my head that I do want to talk about, and that is if we go up to ProPresenter up here and settings and then devices. In the Mac version, we have Rostalk as an option in addition to MIDI. In the Windows version, it's basically just MIDI. But you'll notice that we've got several other protocols here. Again, there's a use case for Rostalk that would be helpful on the Windows side of things, but there is a way to do that in MIDI. So the fact that MIDI is present in both is fine. Actually very helpful. Now, you'll notice that there's a bunch of other protocols, including DMX. You might also know that I've never done a tutorial on those. Maybe sometime in the future. I actually have a global cache from my last corporate job that I could pull out, hook into my network, and deal with it. But basically, as far as communication goes, the vast majority of people use MIDI. Probably the second most common one is Rostalk, and the rest of these are almost never used whatsoever. So it's probably not the case that you're going to miss that. You might use DMX under certain circumstances, but that's about it. So that's the last difference that I can think of off the top of my head between the Mac version and the Windows version of ProPresenter. If you like this content, you'd probably like my ProPresenter Quick Start course. So head on over to TDM.fyi/ProQuick. Give me your name and email address, and I'll make a login for you for free. Till next time, this is Paul Allen Clifford from TrinityDigitalMedia.com and ChurchTechU.com, reminding you to go out and change eternity.